So let's pick up where we stopped yesterday. We are discussing an effective theory for QED. So QED is sort of our full theory, and we want to set up an effective field theory for this. For photon energies, which are much larger, much smaller than the electron energy. And we already made quite a bit of progress. So we started writing down Lagrangians. First a Lagrangian with dimension 4 operators. This included two terms. One is just the standard kinetic term for the photon field. So this Lagrangian just describes three photons. And we introduced a little bit of an interaction by having a background classical current, which couples to this photon field, which is the second term here. And then we were thinking about what operators can arise at for L6, so at dimension 6. And we had written down a number of candidates. I'm not sure I'll use the same numbering scheme now today as yesterday. So there was one which had two field strengths plus two derivatives in the middle between them. And then there was a second one where we had something like this. Mu, rho, nu. This was done in such a way that we arranged these derivatives to be not contracted with the field strength tensor on which they act. So we could write, we wrote more terms, but then we used integration by part to simplify things. And so then we moved the derivatives around so that they don't contract on the field strength tensor they act. And then we also wrote down terms with current operators. For example, something like this. And then a final one with one current and one derivative acting on the field strength. Something like this. Now when I wrote this term, one of the effective field theory professionals in the audience said, ha, but we can use the equation of motion. So the equation of motion for just this Lagrangian L4 is F mu nu is equal to J mu. And the claim was, and this we will now show in a short while, that you can use this equation of motion of the leading power Lagrangian to eliminate operators which you might have thought of writing down at higher powers. And so in particular, if I simply use this equation of motion, I can replace this operator here, which is simply J nu or J mu. And so this O4 will be replaced by an O3. How about the other ones? Is there anything else we can get rid of by the equation of motion? Yeah?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Yesterday there was a statement at the end made that that is not really the equation of motion.
It's really the equation of motion for L4, but of course our Lagrangian will be L4 plus the L6 we will now construct plus the L8. So it's an infinite string of Lagrangians and it has a very, very complicated. But there's the simple equation of motion, which you know from the electrodynamics course, which is the one for the lowest order Lagrangian. And the claim is this is good enough to simplify the Lagrangian. You don't need to know the equation of motion for this full beast of a Lagrangian. Good, so any, yes?
L2 you could also replace by integration by parts two times, and then you could
Exactly, so I can I arranged it just in order not to have too many terms that these do not act on this, of course, but of course I can reverse it. So I can move this one over to here, so that it's d mu f mu nu, and I can move the other one, so I integrate by part. And so then I'm again in the position where I can use this equation of motion, and you see you'll again get a j mu operator. Yes?
And I have another question.
Yes?
Classical equations of motions?
This I still have to prove, so we'll do a nice proof and whatnot, that this is actually that we really can do it, and we'll explain why we can do it. There is one more relation which is hidden, so this Jacobi or Bianchi identity, so this identity, this thing here, I cannot use the equation of motion because the index here contracts on itself on this derivative. In order to be able to use the equation of motion, I need to have d mu f mu nu. But I can actually shuffle around derivatives using this Bianchi identity or Jacobi for this commutator. So if you take the field strength tensor mu mu sigma, then if you cyclically permutate these indices, then you get zero. Plus the last one, d nu f rho mu. So this is zero. And actually, then you can use this. Apply it to this operator, for example, and then one can show. Let me write exercise. So maybe we can do this in detail in the afternoon. So one can find that this, that 2 times this operator O2 is the same as O1. 2 times, let me write that correct relation. 2 times O2 is equivalent to O1 plus a total derivative. So there's a second hidden relation if one uses this. And so now we've can turn this into an equation of motion operator, after which it's just a j times j. We can use the equation of motion here, eliminate this one. We can eliminate this one using this Jacobi identity. So the end result will be the following, that this L6 has one Wilson coefficient and then an operator like this, j mu, j mu. And so that's a contact interaction between these two currents. And it's the only term that is around, and there's a question.
I'm wondering why that, for the purposes of doing calculations in quantum field theory, why that term is needed, because it's a classical field and that just creates an offset in the energy.
Yeah, the question is now, do you need this operator, and for what do you need it? Let's say you want to do photon-photon scattering, then you don't care about this operator because there's not even a photon field in there. But there's an interesting story about this operator. So people wanted to compute, sorry, there's also a mistake here. It should be 1 over me squared because it's dimension 6. So it's 2 dimensions higher and there has to be 1 over me squared. So people wanted to compute corrections to the Casimir energy. So you take some region of vacuum enclosed by some conducting plates. And then you can compute this vacuum energy or its change if you move the plates around. And there was one computation which was just done in ordinary QED. It got one result. And then there was another computation done in the effective theory, which is called Euler-Heisenberg effective theory. And the two disagreed. And so then, as usual, when there are disagreements, the effective field theory people said, our computation is much simpler. We have this beautiful effective Lagrangian, and so we have a much simpler computation, so it's clear that our result is correct, while your complicated QED computation must be wrong. And of course, the QED people said, well, this effective field theory, they never work anyhow. Of course, the QED people were correct. And the reason that they were correct is that the effective field theory people had forgotten to include this operator, because so this has to do with classical currents. So I don't know. So in the full theory, well, let me draw it like this. So there's this current JMU. And then in QED, you can have two such currents, JMU. And then you can, for example, have a vacuum bubble in between. So this is a QED diagram. If you integrate out the electron, then part of this diagram will do charge renormalization. But part of this diagram also generates a term like this. And if you compute the Casimir energy, then you need to take into account that there is this boundary, and you have to add this operator. So sometimes it's relevant, but of course, if you want to do photon-photon scattering, for example, this operator is not relevant. And we'll also not deal with it further. If we now wanted to determine this coefficient, we would have to compute a diagram like this in QED and then try to read off what the coefficient here is. Good, maybe a mild disappointment that we didn't find some interesting photon-photon interaction, but we'll find it later, yes?
Yeah, I was wondering, before you start doing any calculations, do you have any intuitive reasoning for why the JMU term should be the only one? Like, why we can reduce all the FMU terms to that term?
Maybe. We'll come back a little bit later. I mean, one thing that one can say about this entire construction, that it's a bit a mess. So we wrote down all these operators, and then at the end I said, oh, and there's another relation. So it's easy to get it wrong. For example, if you miss a relation, then you have too many operators, which by itself is not yet a problem, but it's not nice to have too many more operators than physical quantities. Let me come back a little bit later to the, so I'll write you the L8, and then we'll discuss how one would write down an even more general Lagrangian, or if you what would you do if you wanted to write the L12 or something where there's an infinite number of possibilities. But before doing this, I want to show that this statement is correct, that we can really eliminate this equation of motion operators using the leading power equation of motion. So, and the reason, well, let me first define what an equation of motion operator is. So, an equation of motion operator is an operator which takes this form. It has something, and then this something is multiplied by the classical equation of motion. If mu nu minus j nu. And the claim is that these do not contribute to physical quantities. And the reason that they do not is that they can be eliminated using a field redefinition. Using so now to show this. I will now do a field redefinition. I could discuss this for the photon field, but it's easiest to discuss it for a generic field. So I'll write the field phi. And now I'll do a field redefinition. So you should imagine this entire effective field theory is set up in a path integral. This path integral has the field as an integration variable. And now I do a change of integration variables in this path integral. So I write this as a new field phi prime. Plus some other function fx, which will depend on the field. What will be important is that this other function with which I do the change, this should be some higher power object. So this field has dimension 1, and then I want to add something which has higher dimension. principle, I don't have to do this, but in order to show this, this is helpful. And so, of course, what I'm doing here is I'm introducing this new field, and I can view this f here as a small variation delta phi. And it is small because this is a higher dimensional operator. And now I can look at the effective Lagrangian. So I can write it in the original field. I can plug in the field redefinition. And then, of course, if I neglect the f, then I get back the Lagrangian which I already had. And then I get extra terms. The leading extra term contains 1 power of f. And of course, this extra term is just the variation. Maybe I didn't even want to write it like this. The variation with respect to the field times the variation itself, which is this f of phi. And then it's plus order f squared. And of course, this variation is just the classical equation of motion of the Lagrangian. So this here, I'm hitting the line again. So this here is just the equation of motion here. And so what happened, if I do this field redefinition, then to order f, I simply add f times the equation of motion to the effective Lagrangian. And now I can use that if this f is higher power, maybe rather, well, let me write what I would use for QED. So for QED, I would take the A mu, write it as an A mu prime, and then plus some coefficient kappa over e squared times j mu plus or kappa 1 plus a coefficient kappa 2 over e squared, and then here I take d mu f mu. So this here, when I do the counting, this here is order lambda. This is order lambda cubed. And so this, when I plug this in to the leading, so now let's do the expansion. If I do this, this is already suppressed by 2 powers of m squared. And so I can use the leading order equation of motion here up to higher order terms. So up to terms of order 1 over m to the fourth, I can use the leading order equation of motion here. And also these f squared terms, because it's a 1 over m squared, they will be 1 over m to the fourth. So also these only enter in the L8. So if I'm not interested in this L8 for the moment, what happens is by doing this field redefinition, I add 2 new terms to the Lagrangian, which have the form d mu times, so it's j nu times this, and the other one is this d mu nu times this. So it's exactly the 2 terms we eliminated in the Lagrangian. And so by adjusting, if I have the Lagrangian with the 2 terms, I do a field redefinition, I can choose this kappa 1 and kappa 2 coefficients in such a way that these terms exactly cancel and go away. Yes, I'm not sure why I write. Okay, let me write f of x here. Yeah. I mean, it depends on the fields too, yes. you see it in the concrete example. Of course, this F is the sum of these two terms. So this is F, and it contains the field. It also contains this J mu in our case. Yes.
F is also delta phi prime, right?
Yes, exactly. I call it delta phi prime here in order to see that what you do when you what you get if you do this is the variation of the action and you get the equations of motion. But for us, this F is just basically the operators we want to eliminate, or more precisely, it's exactly these sort of coefficient parts of the operators we want to eliminate. And so now we've done this. With this field redefinition here, we eliminated the two extra operators in L6. And now we go to L8. Of course, doing this field redefinition has somehow changed the L8. But at this point, we haven't cared yet. So now we go to L8. We again write all the operators that we can write down. This will again include equation of motion operators. But the coefficients of these equation of motion operators will be lambda to the fifth. So then I can do new field redefinitions, which are lambda to the fifth. Now for these lambda to the fifth, I only change the L8. And the F squared terms will be even higher power. So again, if I'm only interested in L8, I can eliminate all the equation of motion operators in L8. And so I can do one field redefinition after another. And from the lowest to the highest Lagrangian I'm interested in, eliminate all these terms. So that's the reason why I can do this. Even though this is in principle a classical equation of motion, but the field redefinition is something I can do in the path integral. Now there's one small thing which I've swept under the rug. Of course, if you do a field redefinition, that it's fine, and we've discussed what it does to the Lagrangian, but also it changes the measure. So in principle, you also have to discuss what happens to the path integral measure if you do such a redefinition. So in our case, we originally had this path integral over phi, and then we do the field redefinition, and then we integrate over the new field phi prime. And then there's in principle this Jacobian delta phi delta phi prime. Now it turns out, and that's one of the reasons why it's nice to use dimensional regularization, that this Jacobian is trivial if you use dimensional regularization. So in this outline PDF, there's a link to my two lecture notes of mine, where I actually show this explicitly if you want to see this. So the way to analyze this is, so you have this Jacobian. This is just, this is basically the delta. So the operator in here is delta x minus y plus delta f delta psi prime. So we can write down what this operator is. And then in order to deal with the Jacobian, you can introduce a ghost field. I'll come to you in a second. You can put it up in the Lagrangian, and then you can use Feynman rules, and you can try to compute this Jacobian. And you'll find that all the loop contributions which you get are scaleless integrals, and so you don't get any. And now there was another question.
Yeah, do we aim at unshelved effective actions? Because otherwise you would have, if you do gauge vexing by ghost fields, you would in principle have to include some of these operations in your effective action, right? I mean, because your equations of motions would contain ghost fields in principle.
It's true that I also have to do gauge fixing at one point. I think the simplest point is to sort of do this at the end, so I can first construct this gauge invariant Lagrangian, okay. And then if I really want to evaluate the path integral, I have to do something. And so I have to add gauge fixing, and this I have to do in the standard QED, but I also have to do it in the effective theory. But I think this part you can do independently in both cases.
But the operators do mix with now the if you're not looking at on-shell.
Now let me now come to the next question. Now the question is, of course I can do this variable change, but how about physics? I mean, now we want to compute something. And of course the field phi prime is not the same as the field phi. And if you just compute correlation functions of the field phi prime, they will not be the same as the correlation functions of the field phi. However, the scattering amplitudes are the same. And the reason is simply that the two fields, this field phi and phi prime, before and after the redefinition, they have exactly the same quantum numbers. All I did is I added something small to the field, which also has to have the same quantum numbers in order to keep things consistent. So let's say, I don't know, if this was a Higgs field, then this is equally well a Higgs field. Or if this was a photon field here, this is also a photon field. So if you compute scattering amplitudes, what you'll have to do is you have to go through this LSC reduction formalism. And of course, the Green's functions will be different, but the scattering amplitudes are the same. So you get the same on-shell amplitudes. And the only thing that I want here is on-shell amplitudes. It's true that if you really wanted to reproduce all the Green's functions of this field A, then you should not do this, and you should include all these operators. And you can do it. So you can reproduce the full off-shell Green's function in QED, but if you do this, you will have to include all these dimension 6 operators we had, and you cannot get rid of them. And then. Good. Yes?
When you do the reduces again and again of the fields, you go to higher orders, you will have like A mu will be equal to AN, A mu N, plus a series. What is the power series, right?
Yes.
What does that power series mean? Or is that really meaning or not?
I mean, we have this expansion in lambda, and at each given order, whenever I construct the Lagrangian of a given order, I do the appropriate field redefinitions at this order so that the square of this field, the F square terms, will be so at such high order that I don't need them yet. And then, of course, this changes these higher Lagrangians, but I also have all this freedom in the higher order Lagrangian. You could also do a field redefinition where you would write down the most general one. So I would ask kappa 1 times j mu plus kappa 2 times this, plus kappa 3 over m to the fourth, and then I would more terms and more terms. So, you get infinitely many terms, but these infinitely many terms correspond to all these equation of motion operators which you eliminate. But rather than doing it like this, I find it easier to understand sort of one step at a time. So we do this for L6. Once we're done for L6, we'll only continue using field redefinition with higher power or higher lambda operators, which no longer change the L6 and only the higher Lagrangians. Good, so that's an important property, and one reason that this standard model effective field theory Lagrangian had too many terms is that some combinations of terms could be eliminated using this equation of motion field redefinitions. Good. So if you really want photon-photon scattering, then I should go to L8. And we should again write down everything we could, etc. But let me write down the result. I want to use the same C1 and C2. So I want to write a string of four Fs, F, rho, mu. So it's these two operators that you get without any currents. And then, of course, one can also get operators with currents.
How much you would like to have another F?
Ah, yes, then it's less zero. Yes. F. Yes, I said four, but then got tired after three of them. Good. And so then I would like operators with currents. I think one such operator is this, and the other one is this here, E A mu. Yes, A mu. J mu. I think these are the operators. Now, to be perfectly honest, the first line, if you don't introduce this external background field, this is given more or less, this you find more or less in every field theory book or so mentioned somewhere. The second line, unfortunately not. So I was trying to search the literature whether these are really all of them. I don't see that I can eliminate these by this equation of motion argument, but I haven't found any paper which actually lists these operators. So if you find one more operator here that I missed, then I should give you a bottle of wine or something. So that is the challenge. Please find an operator which I missed here. One way to search is that you could think about operators with derivatives. I mean, what can you do is you could, you can't do three Fs. That, we said, doesn't work. But you could do two Fs and four derivatives. Now, that's a lot of derivatives, and that's why I think these vanish. These all vanish, but I haven't really proven it. So I think this is the correct Lagrangian, but please prove me wrong. We can maybe now come back to your question of how one continues to construct these Lagrangians. And there's basically two ways. One is more or less brute force, and the other is to use mathematics or something. So the brute force way would be to really write some computer program which simply takes all these building blocks and then generates all of them. So for this L8, it's eight of these covariant derivatives or etc. currents to some power. And then you implement in your code all these relations we had. So you implement the Jacobi, you implement the product rule for derivatives and all this stuff you implement. And then you write a code which starts with this very large list of operators and then goes through them and eliminates one after the other using all these properties we have. And so that's one way things are done. And it's a viable way. But one can, there are more elegant methods which have been developed over the past years. So one thing one can notice here, just in the structure of these Fs. So this here, I mean, this is really F squared, and then the sort of that, you can write the trace of it in matrix notation. So F is a 4 by 4 matrix. I multiply two Fs and take the trace. And then here I multiply four Fs and I take the trace. And so you could fear that if you go to higher and higher orders that you would need more and more powers of these Fs, so that it would be obviously only even powers, but that you would need F to the 8, F to the etc. But there's a nice relation. So there's a theorem, Cayley-Hamilton theorem, which says that if you have a 4 by 4 matrix, that if you take its fourth power, you can re-express it to lower powers. Or if you take a 10 by 10 matrix, you only need to consider up to the 10th power. Everything can be expressed to lower ones. Now, for an antisymmetric matrix like our F, I can write F to the fourth is equal to 1 half trace F squared times F squared minus the determinant of F times the unit matrix. So you can eliminate the fourth power of the matrix So terms which have two powers or only the determinant. And if you write in terms of invariance what this is, this is the usual f squared, so this is 2b squared minus e squared. This determinant here is e times b squared. And so you have sort of, if you use this relation repeatedly, even if you start with f to the tenth, you can break it down to lower and lower f's. And then at the end, if you take the trace, it will only involve these two invariants. So there's an invariant phi 1. And there's an invariant phi 2. And I think if you don't have an external current, these are the only invariants you can write down. In d equals 4. And so all the higher power Lagrangians will be given by products of these fields phi 1 and phi 2 plus derivatives of these fields. So now we've reduced the problem to basically writing down invariants for these scalar fields. And there's of course, the mathematicians have thought a lot about these invariants. There's something called the Hilbert series, where you write some nice rational function, and if you expand it in a Taylor series, it will tell you exactly how many invariants you can construct out of these basic blocks at each order. And very recently, people also have managed to implement this, the integration by part relations and equation of motions into such a formalism. So there is a formalism now, which really spits you out the operators at higher orders without any work. I mean, there is some equation one has to solve, but it's some integral one solves, and then one has some code, it runs, and it gives out. So the people here, the paper is still getting used to the paperless office. So for more, see 1706-08-520. So this is by Henning, Lu, Melia, and Murayama. They had a paper where they constructed the standard model effective Lagrangian using these methods which they describe here, and they could go up to dimension 12, and the title of the paper is something like 2, 60, 75, and then the numbers rapidly increase, and the numbers are the number of terms you get at each order in the construction of the Lagrangian. So there is a constructive method now which simply gives all these terms. But I should warn you that the paper is 120 pages, and it says, well, we'll introduce some concepts not usually familiar to physicists from mathematics, and I find it hard to impossible to read this paper. If you want the taste of it, of these methods, you can look at the summer school lectures by Anish Manohar. So he gives some simple examples for this Hilbert series, which constructs this invariant. Simple examples. Good. But we'll stop here with the construction of the Lagrangian. And now I want to do a bit of physics with this Lagrangian. And of course, the next step in the construction is to determine these Wilson coefficients C1 and C2.
Sorry, what about gauge invariance? You wrote it with two less terms, there is A explicitly.
Yes, with the current, this looks horrible, but fortunately, d mu applied to the current is. Yes, exactly. This is only consistent if this is a conserved current. You can write it like this if you want. Then it looks better.
Okay, this term is okay, but the last one, I cannot see why this is the invariant, sorry.
This one is exactly the same.
No, because when you integrate by parts, you have derivatives on F2.
Ah, well, okay, yeah. If I replace it here, of course, I have to keep the brackets also for the derivative. So I would have to do, if you want to write this as a d mu, keep the brackets also with the derivative so that it doesn't act on the f. It would still be gauge invariant if it also acts on the F. But if it acts on the F, it will produce this equation of motion terms. Let's hope it would do this, and then we could eliminate it. Good, so in our, I don't know how many, four-step or five-step program of setting up an effective field theory, the next step would be matching. But before matching, I want to show you that even if you can't do the matching, you can get interesting results from this effective Lagrangian. So in our heart, what we really think we're doing is we're constructing the standard model effective theory there. We don't have the full theory yet, hopefully by the end of the workshop. Then we will be able to do the matching, but for the moment we'll just have operators and we don't know what the coefficients are. But we can use, let's use this now to do photon-photon scattering. Now in order to do this, you will have to derive Feynman rules for this F times F squared squared. That is somewhat painful because this has four fields and four derivatives, so it's Feynman rules with derivatives. This is something we could discuss in the afternoon if you want how to do this. But of course, what will be the case is that if you compute these diagrams here, you have two terms in your Lagrangian. The first has four powers of the photon field, and the other one also has four powers of the photon field. And if you want to compute the cross section here, you have to sum these two to get the amplitude, and then you have to square the amplitude. So now we don't know what C1 and C2 is, but nevertheless, these are dimensionless numbers. So if we appeal to naturalness, let's say, well, these should be presumably of order 1. And then we can get the rest of the dependence of the scattering cross-section. So let's look at the dependence on the electron mass first. So we've used these operators in 08. These are dimension 8, so they're suppressed by 1 over m electron to the fourth. So there's a 1 over m electron to the fourth. And we squared the amplitude. So that is the dependence on the electron mass. And we immediately know this, and this is nice. If you would do QED and you would draw some loop diagrams, and I would ask you what is the dependence on the electron mass, well, it's not so easy to, or not immediate to guess that it goes like 1 over m to the 8th. So how does it depend on the energy of the photon? I mean, now this is multiplied by the photon energy, of course, to some power n. And do you know what the power n is? Six. Somebody said, why six? Yes, so the cross-section must be 1 over energy squared. And so once you know the m, 1 over m to the 8th, you know that the rest has to be photon energy to the 6th. There is just simply no other energy scale around. And so here it really pays off that we've separated these two energy scales, because now we can just do dimensional analysis and we get all the dependence of the cross-section correct. And the rest is then just some combination, some number, which of course involves the C1 and C2s. And of course it will be somewhat painful to compute this because you have to do these Feynman rules. But in principle, the most important statement here is this statement here. One can even go a little bit farther. I mean, this photon scattering in QED will involve a loop. So it will be this loop with four photons attached. So that gives a suppression by e to the fourth or alpha squared. Yes, of course, yes. So that's exactly the point I'm trying to make. These C1s and C2s, they will depend on the electron charge. because when I compute this process in QED, it will involve a loop. So these will be proportional to alpha. And here I square this, so this will go like alpha s, not alpha s, sorry, it's professional deformation, like alpha to the fourth. And you get a pretty good estimate of this cross-section with a little work. Well, okay, we worked for several hours to write down the Lagrangian, but once you have it, the result is more or less immediate. You also see that maybe this naturalness is a bit overrated, so this is, of course, a number of order 1. But order 1 is alpha s to the 4th. So it's if you're too naive here about these coefficients, and if you forget that they're powers of the coupling, you would get the wrong result. Now the sad thing is, of course, if you're at low energies, this is very strongly suppressed, both by the energy and then also by the coupling, so it's doubly suppressed. So if you ever have a laser sword, for example, and you do the laser sword fight and you cross these lasers, it will be extremely hard to see any scattering. They will just go through each other. So that's the bad news. Good. Now I have derived the Feynman rules and I have done the computation for the scattering amplitude. Maybe. Not sure whether it's super important to write it down, but just because I'm so proud that I did it. Squared. So that's the result if you really do the computation. And now this shows us how we can obtain this coupling coefficient C1 and C2. What we will have to do is, this is the computation in the effective theory, depends on this parameter C1 and C2. Now we'll have to do the same computation in QED, and then we can read off what the coefficients C1 and C2 are. So this is called matching. And in QED, we already discussed what will happen. So we'll have these loop diagrams like this. Let me write the amplitude. Now there are different combinations here. So I have these four external lines. And there are different diagrams, but the diagrams only differ by the different permutations of these things. I mean, one permutation is I can take this and reverse the order 1, 2, 3, 4 into this reverse. That gives the same diagram. So this is a factor of 2 here. Then I can do one case where I exchange 3 and 4. That's again two of these, and then there's a final one where I exchange 2 and 3. So I've drawn the diagrams in a strange way. Of course, usually order all the external momenta, you put them at the same place, but then the box will get twisted. So that's why.
It's not enough in the cross section, right? Because you got two constants.
Yeah, so there's a problem. Good question. So there's only one linear combination, and so it's clear that if I compute this cross section, I will only get one linear combination. So what's the solution to this? I haven't even said what the cross section is, but these four photons have some polarizations, And here I've averaged over the incoming ones and summed over. So this is the unpolarized cross-section. That is not good enough. That only gives one combination. So I need to compute two different polarizations in this amplitude in order to do the matching. What else? So I need enough observables in order to determine both coefficients, but then I can choose the simplest observables with which I can do it. So, for example, you see here that the angle dependence is kind of trivial. So it's good enough to compute the forward scattering. But two different helicity configurations. There's another simplification I can make. These matching coefficients, they don't really depend on this photon momentum, so I can play with the momentum. It's problematic to set it to zero because the entire amplitude has an e gamma to the sixth. So I need to keep some momentum, but it can be as small as I want. Anyhow, at the end, I have to compute this amplitude and then expand. And what I'm taking here for the matching is just the leading term in this expansion. And now it turns out that if you write these diagrams, you can actually expand already on the integrand level. This is a dangerous thing usually. Integration and expansion doesn't always converge. Commute. But here it commutes. So you can take these integrals and you can expand the integrands. In the external momenta. Once you do this, all these momenta will go out of the denominators of the loop integrals. So then all the loop integrals... The electron mass you need to keep. So the electron mass is the large scale.
Yeah, that's why. So mean, but you have a rho, and then you have a small parameter there, like 1 over m e, and then you have this one in 2, so this small parameter...
Exactly, so the small parameter I do in pi over m electron. Of course, you say, well, there should be a relation. No, but there shouldn't. This is a photon momentum, so there's no relation. So it's really just expanding in this. So this is like lambda. This is our expansion parameter. And you take the integrand and you expand in all the four momenta. Then they go away from the denominator. They appear in the numerators. And all the loop integrals, I mean, you can have some k squares in the numerator and some, some power in the numerator, some powers in the denominator, and this is sort of the basic one-loop integral you find in every textbook. So it's by doing this expansion, this looks difficult because it's box diagrams, but at the end all you need is type of vacuum bubble type of integrals. Now I said that it's in general it's dangerous to interchange expansion and integration. But actually, the professionals always do this. So the most efficient way to do matching computations is to always expand the integrand. This needs a bit more discussion. What happens if you do this is you automatically kill all the low energy parts, and you're left with the high energy parts, which are exactly what you need in the matching. So this goes under the name method of region expansion. And hopefully I'll get there in the last lecture.
But then you have to know what your degrees of freedom to expand.
Yeah, so of course, when you have a more complicated integral, the question is how do you expand it? And so there's this entire, so this method of region technique with which you expand integrals. Here there will be two momentum regions when you have more complicated, a low energy region and a high energy region. And by naively expanding the integrand, you kill the low energy region and you're left with the high energy region. But anyhow, that's a foot. I didn't really explain it, and it's a footnote. For these integrals, you can just check that it's fine to expand. Nothing happens when you do it. And so then you compute them, and then you get these Wilson coefficients. And well, okay, then there would be quite a bit of work, and you would get the first coefficient as minus 1 over 36 alpha squared, and the second one yes? The entire, so you look at the integrand, it has obviously the loop momentum, and it has these external momenta pi. So I expand in all the external momentum in the momenta in the loop diagram. That is in general dangerous, but if you take this diagram and write it down, you'll see that nothing happens. Well, it will simplify greatly because, of course, all these momenta run through these internal propagators. You have all these fermion propagators with momenta, and it will be a tough computation to do it. If you simply expand them away, then all these propagators here will be k squared minus m squared. And all the momenta will just be a Taylor coefficients which appear upstairs. And these Taylor coefficients are then sort of the derivatives of this operator f mu nu. And you get the right structure of the numerator. Good. So one remarkable thing, and that will not, we will do another example on Thursday in the third lecture with this weak quark decays. There we will find that the coefficients will have divergences if you do this matching, so they have to be renormalized. Here, things do not need to be renormalized, which is interesting. And it comes from the fact a little bit that our L4, the leading order Lagrangian, is just a free theory. And so the leading order Lagrangian by itself doesn't really produce any loops. That's different for this quark case. There, the leading order Lagrangian will be QCD, so there's all these QCD loops. But here, there are no QED loops because the leading theory is just free photons. So we should maybe discuss what types of loop corrections one could get. So can you come up with a one-loop contribution to photon-photon scattering in this effective theory? So we computed the tree level, which is here. How about the one loop? Exactly, just take two of them. So I can use my operator here. C1, I don't know, 1 or 2, and here also C1, 2. And so at what order will this come in? 1 over m to the 8, you said, or?
Yeah.
Exactly, so we have one term from this L8 Lagrangian. So this comes with C1, 2 over ME to the 4th, this one too.
But there is no loop correction to 1 over M to the 4th.
So there is no loop correction to 1 over M to the 4th. So the problem is if I take two terms from this L8, which has this interaction, then the loop will be suppressed. So it will be M to the 8th. So only if you go to this order, you will need this loop. There is one loop you could imagine doing just with a single single insertion, but then, I mean, well, this is, first of all, it's not the loop correction to scattering, it's more like a self-energy type of correction. And it will actually vanish when you, it's a typical diagram that vanishes in dimensional regularization. So there are no loop corrections also at order 1 over m to the m electron to the fourth. Then it's of course interesting, so what will happen here? Is this zero or non-zero? And I didn't know, but last week I went through the literature and here I found an answer. Somebody has computed this and it's non-zero. And it's also not finite, it has a divergence. So there is genuine low energy loops and low energy physics. But it's the same order as the dimension 12 Lagrangian. So there will be a dimension 12 Lagrangian which has to renormalize this loop. And they wrote it down and it actually involves these invariants we discussed and it also some derivative. It involves some explicit derivatives. So that brings me to another bracket, another fundamental thing we should discuss. And this is power counting in this effective field theory. So we've sort of just went through it by example and we looked at the diagrams and you see that it's pretty simple to see where a diagram contributes. But we can sort of formalize this and think about at what order, what part enters. So this is again sort of a bracket here. And this power counting is just the counting of the powers of lambda, so of the expansion parameters. We've done it here, and we said this diagram is 1 over m to the 8th. We've done it here. We said this cross-section here is lambda to the 8th, for example. And now we can do it for an arbitrary diagram. So let's use a dimensionless observable. Dimension and let's assume in the computation of this dimensionless observable we used n operators element of n operators in this effective Lagrangian. And these operators have dimensions ni, but we again introduce this quantity ki where we subtract the dimension from this. So this I here goes from 1 to the n. So in our example, for example, this one-loop scattering amplitude involved the matrix element of two such operators. And the two operators had dimension 8. So there's two k's, and each of these k's, the n minus d is 4. So the contribution to this observable from this n operators then scales like lambda to the k. And this k here is just the sum of the individual ki's. So that's the power counting formula with which if I give you any Lagrangian here with any power, and you compute something, you can immediately read off at what accuracy in lambda this operator will contribute. And this is true. So this is true also at the loop level, not only at the tree level. So it doesn't matter whether this is a seven-loop computation or a one-loop computation. All that matters is which operators are occurring. Good, so we should prove the theorem. So here's the proof. So that's the proof of the theorem. The trick is we have these explicit factors of the large scale to some power, and this power is exactly this k. Each operator comes with this. And these prefactors never enter any of the computations. Even if it's a 17-loop integral, this 1 over m to e to the something is just a prefactor. So simply move this prefactor out. And so the rest will now only depend on low energy scales. But we said the observable is dimensionless. And so since it's dimensionless, the power of low energy stuff has to exactly match the power of this big lambda. And so the entire thing has to count in this way. So it's extremely simple to know what term you need at what accuracy in dimensional regularization. And it's one thing which makes dimensional regularization so efficient and nice. So let me tell you why DIMREG is essential here. So if you use a hard cutoff, so if you say, well, I don't want to go to d dimensions, I'll just put hard cutoffs on my loop integrals, and you start doing loop integrals, you get terms which go like this. Lambda cutoff over lambda. So these are the UV parts of these loop integrals. You can get power divergences which have this form. And these now break this simple counting. Now you have terms which are all of a sudden order 1. Now these terms will involve the high scale, and it's no longer obvious at which order this comes in. Now, of course, the physics result in some sense shouldn't matter which regularization you used. And what happens is, these power divergences you can absorb into renormalization of lower dimensional operators. So once you subtract all these power divergences and only keep the physically interesting terms, then this power counting will again be this. But it will be a major pain when you do a loop computation. You get all these power divergences, and they will change all the coefficients of lower order operators. So you have to rearrange after each computation your entire Lagrangian. And only then this counting is simple again. I mean, one problem with the cutoff in effective theories is that this cutoff reintroduces the high energy scale into the low energy theory. And this makes it very difficult to do simple things. For example, this power counting is no longer as simple, while in DIMREG, the low energy theory only knows about low energy scales, and so you can really and very easily count. After subtracting the power divergences. Subtracting power divergences. And so DIMREG does this very nicely. It automatically kills all these power divergences. You're automatically only left with the interesting parts of the computation, and the interesting parts fulfill this counting. Yes?
Just in general, could there also be the chance that some logarithmic contributions for the lambda, or is it just not possible in DIMREG?
Yes, of course, this is, if you want, the naive counting. Then the Wilson coefficients here, they have logarithmic dependence on the electron mass once you get interesting loops. And of course, then there's also logarithmic dependence here. So here the idea is these are the pure powers. So these are the operator dimensions. But of course in quantum field theory you generate this anomalous dimension. So these dimensions very slightly change. And so this logarithmic part is still there. This only counts the actual powers up to logarithmic pieces. Good. Well, maybe to finish things about this scattering. I mean, if you do a concrete computation, so we have now the leading power result for the scattering amplitude. And let's go over the different sources of corrections which will arise. And we've already had some corrections. So the first correction is the one we computed. We computed, we didn't compute it. Okay, so we have loop corrections to the matching. So we have this Wilson coefficient Ci. There's lower order results and higher order results. So these will all be there. Then we'll have loop corrections from the leading Lagrangian, from this L4. But these are not there for Euler-Heisenberg. And then the final correction is higher dimensional operators. Now this result for gamma-gamma scattering, I've said it's experimentally, this low-energy gamma-gamma scattering hasn't been observed yet because it's so small, even though people, I think, are trying with very energetic lasers to see this. It has been seen, of course, at higher energies, gamma-gamma scattering, even at the LHC. You can indirectly probe this, but at much higher energies. But let's say we're crazy enough that we even want corrections to our result. We say, well, we're precision people. So what is the dominant correction here, and what would I need to do if I want to improve this result? So there will be corrections to the Ci if I do the matching. So these are suppressed by powers of alpha s in QED. So I would need to compute two loop box integrals, and I would get a one loop correction to this coefficient C1 and C2. These are even known. Then usually, for example, in weak decays, you will have corrections from the QCD corrections from the leading order Lagrangian up to some accuracy. These are typically the most important ones, but they're absent here. And then finally, it's higher dimensional operators. And of course, well, these scale with lambda to the power k, while these scale with alpha to the n here in the fundamental theory. Which one you need? Depends a bit what you want. Of course, if you go to very low energies, the higher dimensional operators are all negligible, and all the corrections that are important are corrections to the Wilson coefficients and corrections from the leading power Lagrangian. If you're at somewhat higher energies, these power corrections will be important, and then you, of course, have to sort of count and see, well, how big is this correction compared to the other ones, and you have to figure out which ones you need to include and which ones you don't need to include for a given accuracy. But in principle, it's clear what you need to include just by this power counting. So if your accuracy has to be lambda to the k, let's say lambda to the 4, then you can just look at all the combinations of operators you can write down which add up to this 4. Good. Let me, maybe as a last thing in this Euler-Heisenberg, discuss some neat little application. for the scattering, of course, we worked now quite hard for this photon-photon scattering. Presumably in the 3 hours or 4 hours we spent discussing, I could have done just the QED diagrams on the blackboard and derived the result without any effective Lagrangian. But it's nice, or it gets more efficient if you compute more than one observable. So it's a bit limited from this Euler-Heisenberg Lagrangian, but one thing we can do, for example, is the vacuum energy or the energy density of a photon gas. So that's an application. And the lowest order formula, so energy per volume, is very famous. It goes like t to the fourth power. And it has a coefficient pi squared over 15. So that's the Stefan-Boltzmann law. And of course, you can compute this in our effective field theory. To do it, you have to do a finite temperature computation. And then you have to compute the expectation value of the energy. This, if you do this in terms of diagrams, it's this type of vacuum diagram that you will need to compute. Now, usually, at t equals zero, these vacuum diagrams are scaleless and vanish. But if you're doing a finite temperature computation, then instead of ddk, you have a sum over discrete energies, and then an integral over momenta. And these omega n's are 2 pi n t. These are called Matsubara frequencies. Formally, what happens if you do the partition function for the gas, you can show that it's the same as the Euclidean path integral, where you take time and you compactify time on a circle with this radius beta. And so related to the temperature. And so then, because time is compactified, you get these discrete frequencies. And then instead of a usual loop integral, you have to do this frequency sum. So you can do this, and then you'll recover this result which you've heard in undergraduate physics lectures. Now, this is a photon gas, but you can ask yourself, well, there's also electrons and positrons. So sometimes there will be an electron and a positron popping up in this gas. And you can ask yourself, what is the contribution from electrons? After all, it's not free photons. It's QED. So what is the QED correction to this result? And this is again obtained by computing vacuum diagrams. So we have to compute the expectation value now also with these subleading operators. So you can have a diagram like this, where you insert C1 or C2. And then you again compute this diagram here. It's a two-loop diagram, but it's not a very hard two-loop diagram because it's basically a product of two one-loop diagrams. There's a paper doing this computation. Write the reference. PH98032 16. But again, we can do the same thing that we did for the scattering amplitude. Of course, you have to compute it, but we can count what the correction should be. So the change in the energy density from this, again, we look just at the powers of the electron mass, and it's 4 powers. So it goes like 1 over m electron to the 4th. And then for dimensional reasons, it has to go like temperature to the 8th power. And of course, the coefficient here will be an alpha, and then there will be a number which one really would need to compute. If you do this in QED, you will have to work quite hard. So if you do the same computation in QED, you will also have, of course, this vacuum bubble. But then in QED, there will be diagrams like this, where you have a fermion loop and then one photon, for example. So there are two loop diagrams. This thing here corresponds to some three loop diagrams like this, a three loop diagram like this in the full theory. So you would work very hard. You would first compute all these two-loop diagrams, and you would actually find that the result vanishes. And the reason is that there is no dimension 6 operator there. That's what we showed. It's in principle there in QED, but once you use the equation of motion, you can get rid of it, so you never see this type of a term. And the first contribution will then be at three loops, and it's a trivial three-loop interval as compared to a quite complicated one. So that's just to show that one can simplify computations using the effective field theory. Good. Now we could continue like this. So we did the thing where we integrated out the electron and then wrote down an effective theory just for the photon. It would also be interesting to start with muons and electrons and then to integrate out the electron and write down an effective theory with only electrons and photons. That's a bit more interesting. It gives more operators. But we will not do it here. What we'll do to finish off today's lecture is, I mean, all of this was kind of an exercise to build the standard model effective theory. So I want to show you the standard model effective theory, Lagrangian. And it's too many operators. Here we only had two or one at dimension 6. And now we can look how this looks in the standard model. It turns on. Do you see?
Yeah.
Oops. Good, of course, at the underlying level, this is the full theory here. I've seen you've seen presumably exactly this formula in Michael Peskin's lecture. So there's the dimension 4 Lagrangian, then there's dimension 5 and dimension 6. It's interesting that there's this dimension. Well, let's first discuss how to write it down. So in principle, it's exactly the same exercise as Euler-Heisenberg. It's just there are a bit more fields. So of course, you have all these fermion fields. All these fermion fields have charges under the gauge groups. In particular, they all have different hypercharges. And so you now have to write down operators which are neutral under all these gauge groups and which are Lorentz scalars, etc. Of course, in addition to the gauge field, you now also have the Higgs scalar, so that also adds possibilities. And we have three gauge fields rather than a simple one, single one. Good, so what's interesting is that depending on what you do, you can have a dimension 5 operator if you allow for lepton number violation. You can write down one operator, and it's quite remarkable that it's only one operator. So this is the one which gives Majorana masses to neutrinos. From the fact that the neutrinos are very light, that seems to indicate, that indicates that the coefficient of this is 1 over lambda, that this lambda is quite high. And now, well, okay, now then the dimension 6 is where it really happens, where you can have many operators. So this was first done by Buchmüller and Wieler. And then people noticed that there were too many operators. There were some equation of motion operators. I think there was maybe also one or two they missed. But it took a long time until these people here then really went and wrote down the complete operator basis, looking at all the relations, etc. And so it's some of the relations we've seen and some of the properties we can use, like integration by part and the equation of motion. With Dirac fields, you have additional identities, like the Fields identities, which Monica has mentioned. And then, then there are these famous 60 operators. The 60 operators, however, have flavor indices. So it depends how you count. If you count the number of coefficients, it's a large number, which one almost doesn't want to say. And here are the operators. This one here is nice. So we have seen that this 3 F mu nu's doesn't work in QED. But if you have a color index, it does work, because you have the additional color index. So when you flip, this gives an additional minus sign, which compensates the other minus sign. So this operator becomes possible. And you see that both in the SU3 gauge theory, there are then such operators, and also in SU2. But there are none in U1 for the reasons we discussed. Then, of course, there's things with Higgs. There's things with Higgs and gauge fields. There's things with fermions, gauge fields, and Higgs fields, etc. Plus 4 fermion operators. So here are all these 4 fermion operators. This is our operator J mu, J mu. I mean, this here is a current J mu, and so you see all this current. But of course, now there are many fermions, and so there are many different types of combinations and currents you can write. So this is the list of all of them. Of course, the I don't know how many billion-dollar question is what the value of this scale lambda is. So flavor physics, for example, the kaon mixing, which you've seen this morning, seems to indicate that this scale is presumably high. So neutrino masses also point to a very high scale. But of course, there could be different physics sectors which have different sources. It could be that the neutrino masses have a source really at a very high scale, while other new physics enters at the lower scale. The LHC seems to be indicate that the scale has to be larger than TV-ish, because we haven't seen anything. And okay, and now we come back to Craig's lecture. So this you have discussed in detail. The problem is all these experimental indications point to a high value of lambda. But at the same time, you also have a dimension 2 operator. And this dimension 2 operator, for this, we know the coefficient. And the coefficient is Higgs mass, in essence, squared. And so Higgs mass tells us lambda is small, while all the other experiments tell us that lambda is high. And so that's the naturalness problem, that you get two different answers for the same question. What is maybe, I'm sure Craig said all this, what is important is that this lambda here, below the red line with the slides, the lambda in this continuum effective field series is not some cutoff. So in this Wilsonian framework, we would integrate out, and there would be some lambda or so. There is no, this lambda here is some physical scale. And it's the scale where new physics will show up. And so when people talk, so you don't need to talk about quadratic divergences or anything. It's really just the fact that if there is new physics at some scale lambda, and if you do the matching, you should see contributions proportional to lambda squared. And if this lambda is very high, it's strange that the Higgs mass isn't. Good. So I think that's all for the moment. And see you in the afternoon.